So, hi. I will speak about the Workcook project. First, MediaRea, my company, is an open source software company focused on digital media analysis. So maybe you already heard about some tools like MediaInfo, MediaConch, QC Tools, BWF MetaEdit, for example, AVI MetaEdit, MOV MetaEdit, DV Analyzer. So a lot of different tools for answering to the issues you may have in your work. Let's talk about some AV files you can have in your repository based on one file per frame, so TIFF or DPX, maybe you have that in your workflow. The issue with such kind of tool package, I will say, is that you have thousands or hundreds of thousands of files in for one video stream. And sometimes the workflow does not like that, and your LTO does not like that too, so you do some tar and so on. It is not playable by several players, and there is some interoperability issues. Sometimes you can play it in your own player, but someone else cannot play the same DPX with their own player, because it is not the same flavor interoperability problems. Okay, let's try to change that, to fix some of the issue we found with DPX and TIFF files in your workflow. We want to compress that with FFV1. So we talk about FFV1 a bit this morning, and so I repeat a bit what we talk about this morning. It is a lossless video compression format, so you lose no information when you compress with FFV1. It is an open source format, so everyone can fork the specification and update the specification for his needs. It is patent free, so there is no risk about patent. If you take, for example, H.264 or HEVC, you have to pay a license every time you use it officially. A bit more in the US, a bit less in Europe. Thank you, Europe. FFV1 is adopted as a native format by several archives, and it is more and more used. It is being standardized by IETF, so we don't go through SMPT or ISO. We use IETF because it is more open than the other entities, and the format will be free to download, open access. The format can be also forked without having any issue to be issued because you use one part of one another format. So if you try to do the same thing with HEVC and so on, you will have a couple of lawyers around you. FFV1 also permits you to divide by slice the frame. So Peter talked about that this morning. But we didn't talk about the compression. Sometimes you may want to say, I just have to zip the files, and it is okay. But zipping TIFF or DPX files, it is not so performant. The speed issue, so you need, for example, for 1 second of content, you need 10 seconds for the compression, and the compression is pretty bad. You can try with a more modern format like LZMA. It is even longer and a bit better for the compression, but not like FFV1. So you can see the numbers that FFV1 is faster, better compression. So we prefer to use it in the workflow compared to zip and so on. One disadvantage currently of FFV1 alone is that FFV1 is focused on the content, what you see, the visual content, not on the metadata. So if you compress your DPX and TIFF into FFV1, we keep the visual content, but we don't keep the DPX and TIFF metadata. So it is not exactly the same thing like a zip or tar, because when you revert to DPX, for example, you have DPX or TIFF, but not exactly in the same kind of the same flavor, Little Endian, Big Endian, and so on. So sometimes we want that to be able to retrieve exactly the DPX and the TIFF, exactly as it was before the compression. And also, there is some difficulties to understand the FFmpeg command line sometimes for compressing your DPX. So we want to help about that. And this is why Rockhooked project was born. It is a problem for archivists. They want to better compress in order to have a better storage cost, for example, but they also want to be able to revert back to DPX and TIFF the real files. So not the same kind, not the DPX, just a DPX, but the exact same DPX. So Rockhooked helped to store the content in FFV1, but also we store the metadata in Matroska attachment. We also store any other sidecar files we find in the directory, so XML files. You can have some hash files and so, or some subtitles, some log files. We put all of them in attachment in Matroska file. And with that, we can have reversibility. So if you write Rockhooked and your directory name, we convert it like zip in a single file, a Matroska file. And if you do Rockhooked and this Matroska file name, we revert back to the original directory with the exact same files, like a zip. It is just better compression, playable by VLC, and so on. We can also, with Rockhooked, add some easy check of integrity. So now, with Rockhooked, you can check that the file is healthy. So, for example, if the hard drive or your LTO was a bit corrupt, you can easily check that and find where is the corruption. You can also try before to convert DPX to Matroska. At the same time, you can do a conformance checker of DPX, because sometimes you have your DPX, but you are not sure that they are standard. So why not when we do the compression, that we also check that the DPX are conform to the specification in order to be sure that all is fine. If you just tar or zip your file, you don't know if what you have in your tar or zip file is standard. So with Rockhooked, we can help to that, and we do some basic checks. Next version, we will add also some error correction code. So if you lose a complete LTO, for example, or any other archive system, if you lose a LTO block or a couple of LTO blocks, it is not a big problem. We can retrieve the LTO block content and get it back the complete file, and we lose nothing. We will not save your file if it is too much corrupt, but if there is some small corruption, we will be able to fix that. And again, it is with very easy command, rockhooked dash dash check, or rockhooked dash dash conch for conformance checker, rockhooked dash dash fix just for fixing the file. So let's take a use case. An archive want to have, they have a scanner from someone else. Okay, a different supplier. Oh, the classic workflow is that your supplier do the scan and send you the DPX. So a lot of files and so on, but you don't know if the DPX is correct or not. With Rockhooked, you do Rockhooked dash dash all, it means that all is conformance checker, we add error correction code, we do a check that all is fine in one command. And after that, you can do the transport. So the size of the package is two times smaller. So it is easier to transport. If you do by internet, sometimes it is two times faster, or you need less hard drives and so on. And when you receive the content, you can check the integrity with Rockhooked dash dash check and the MKV. If you do this command, it also checks that the DPX stored inside this MKV, the DPX metadata, will be correct. So you don't need to unpack the Matroska file to DPX again before checking that the DPX is correct. It is native to the tool. So the Rockhooked data check will also check that the DPX is conform to specification. You can also visually check the content. Sometimes you have your DPX and you don't know how to play it because no player like VLC or Windows Media Player or QuickTime can read it. But with this archive, the Matroska file, you can check visually what is the content. You can store this file, and it is 2 times less costly than using tarring your files, your DPX files. So in terms of cost, it is very practical. So having 2 times less cost for your content may be useful for you, I think. And if you need your DPX file or your TIFF files, oh, it is fine. You do raw cooked and your Matroska file name, and you have back your DPX files. For the moment, thanks to the initial sponsors, we can support nearly any kind of DPX. We support also the TIFF format. RAW format compressed is not supported. So if you have a slight compression in TIFF, it is not supported. But we can support 16-bit TIFF, so the one you can find in DCDM, for example. We also support audio. A bit about audio, we use the FLAC format for compressing the audio to a compressed format. And the FLAC has the same kind of feature than FFV1, but for audio. Our sponsor. So RAW cooked was based on what archives need. So sponsors, it is the archives. And these entities needed some a way to optimize the cost of storage to check that the DPX is wealthy and so on. So this is the ones who make this tool existing. Without them, you could not have such tool. So it is thanks to the sponsors that you can have such such tool for you. It is open source, so and it is made by archivists for archivists. So yeah, here it is the name, not the logo. For having some financial sustainability, we provide the open source code to sponsor without any lock, but on our website we decided to have a lock. So the binaries we provide on our website permit you to test the tool with 8 or 10 bit DPX and with 2 channels waves. If you need to test with your own files, no problem, we can provide a temporary key if you need. And after that, if you want another flavor and you need to buy a key, it is 1,000 euro for the first flavor. And after that, we will ask for a maintenance fee. It is 500 euros, so it is small compared to what you can have, the gain, the cost you save for your storage. Just try to compare how much you can get from the storage when you split by 2 the price and this kind of cost. The current development we have, we are improving the DPX conformance checker, and we are improving the integrated auto check. So when you do raw cooked dash check and your directory, there is some automatic check for being sure that all is correct, and the Erasure code, so we can fix a buggy file. And we will work next year on the speed improvement of FFV1. We want to try to speed up because sometimes it may be considered a bit slow. And for the moment, RAW cooked is a command line interface, and we want to provide a graphical interface so everyone can use it very easily. We have more ideas about what we could do with RAW cooked. We could add support of the DPX reels. For example, for the moment, we need a directory, and if you have reels, we consider that it is different video tracks. We detect them not as a sequential, or but it is sequential content. So if you have 10 minutes, first minute, and 10 other minutes in another directory, for the moment, it is just 2 video tracks and 10 minutes together. We want that the file is playable by VLC in a correct way, so that it is 10 minutes, then 10 minutes, 20 minutes. So it is the kind of development we could do. It is not done for the moment because it was not the priority of the sponsors. And again, the sponsors are the one who decide about the priorities. So one sponsor needs something, he decides to put the money on this item, which is important for them. If you need this this feature, it is easy. You just contact me or any other developer. It is open source again. It is not just me. And you say, oh, I need this feature. So we go ahead. We can also do some speed improvement through the GPU. We hope that it could be interesting to increase the speed with the GPU. We hope it will work. We could have some Bayer support. So instead of having RGB, we could try with a native format of some cameras. We could work also on the creation of an NXS file at the same time. So you don't have only your Matroska file with FFV1. It is lossless, okay, but it is big. So if you want an access file at the same time, we could try to improve our scripting and so on in order to have everything automatic. For the audio, some people have one file for all the channels in the WAV file. So it is good. We convert that to a Matroska file with one track. That's fine. But some people have one file per channel. I don't know why, but it exists. Okay, why not? For the moment, we consider that one file is one track, but some people would like to have all the channels together, because for the moment, if you play the Matroska file in VLC, you will see that you can have track one, and you will have the left channel. If you want the right channel, you need to select track two, but you don't have any more of a left channel. So we want to pack everything together and that you can play all the channels at the same time. It will be better, maybe. And if you have more input format, I don't know, any other kind of format, we could also implement that. So for the moment, we support the input format, the DPX BitDev, or the DPX Indianess, Little Indian, Big Indian, and so on. It is the files from our sponsors. If we don't support your files, we can update the tool. So again, it is the priorities is done by the sponsor. The roadmap is not definitive. We have actually no roadmap. We have our roadmap is what you decide by being a sponsor. And I think I have finished. If you have some questions.
Are there any questions out there? One second.
Stephen McConaughey from the BFI. So Jerome, obviously we're one of the sponsors, and one of the ways people can contribute to this is through sponsorship, but there's other ways too. So I found when we started using it that the operating manual had some missing functionality that was either in the release or in the snapshots. And so one of the things I'm really keen to contribute to and ask others who are among the sponsors is to keep the documentation up to date. So I think there's other ways people can contribute, especially maybe if they're using it without the budget to be a sponsor. So just to say the documentation.
Yes, that's true. Sponsorship is not only about money. It is also it is open source, so you can fork our GitHub repo. You can help in providing more features also, or in providing more documentation. We are lacking of documentation. It is on our to-do list, but we lack of time as often. And if you can help in the documentation, it will be also very great, and it will be available for everyone. So it is not for us as developer, but for the other archivists. So go ahead, and if you think that you are missing some information, you look at it, it is difficult, you can put a summary and offer the change to the project. It would be great.
Anybody else have any questions? Looks like we don't have any more questions, so. No. We can get a head start on welcoming Alex Boix to the stage. Thanks, Jerome.